Today, we just want to say thank you, Lord, for being such a great God. Lord, you are more than wonderful. You're more than glorious. You are splendorous, Lord. You are the great I am, the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning, the end, the first, the last, the author, the finisher of our faith. God, you're altogether lovely, the rose, the Sharon, the lily of the valley, the bright, the morning star. Lord, we have so much to thank you for. We give you honor in our hearts and in your house today, and we thank you for the privilege of coming boldly before a throne of grace. God, along with our thanksgiving and our praise and our adoration, we present our needs before your throne. And Lord, when we present them, we know that you receive them, you acknowledge them, and you fix them. Lord, we lift up Joe Barrett, Lord, who's undergoing some heart procedure this coming week. God, I pray, Lord, you'd go before him, that, Lord, you would guide the doctors as they go in. God, I pray for peace that passes understanding for him and Cheryl both. And God, I pray, Lord, that this would be, Lord, a complete fix. Lord, I pray, God, there'd be no complications, no issues, no problems, Lord, associated with this procedure. But let all be well in Jesus' name. Lord, we lift up Kathy Fogarty, Lord, who needs your healing in her body. And Lord, I pray, God, that you would do a miracle on her behalf. God, Lord, for Maribel Cook, continue to heal and, Lord, continue to touch her body. Lord, for Charity Haltz, who's not feeling well today and needing a healing in her body as well. God, I lift up Jennifer and Sue as they're ministering in the Catlin Church this morning. Let the anointing of the Holy Ghost be ever present on that service as well as here. God, be magnified for Kevin Kipferl, who needs a touch of God upon him. God, send your word to where he is and do what only you can do. God, in the name of Jesus, Lord, you are more than enough, able to do exceeding abundantly above all we can ask or think according to the power that works within us. I thank you that you're a healing Jesus. I thank you that you're a delivering Jesus. I thank you you're empowering Christ. I thank you, Lord, that you do all things well. And Lord, we give you thanksgiving and praise for it in Jesus' name. Minister in this service. Let the word go forth with power and authority. God, let it be, Lord, an effective word. Lord, let it communicate the message you want to be declared and delivered and decreed. And Lord, may it produce fruit that remains. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen and amen. Before you sit down, greet somebody. Let them know you are glad and more than glad they're here. Amen. Praise God. We got a few announcements to make as others are coming. How many are ready for the 4th of July weekend? Woo! Not too many, I guess. How many know that a lot of our freedoms are being challenged, but how many know America is still the greatest nation in the world? Amen. We need to give God a little thanksgiving for the fact that we're living here and not somewhere else. Amen. So I wish you all a happy 4th of July in advance, amen. Tonight we were going to have prayer with the pastor, but due to the holiday weekend, we're going to move it till next Sunday night. We're not canceling it, we're just revisiting it. So next Sunday, July 10th, 5 o'clock for the leaders meeting in the prayer room, and 6 o'clock open prayer, general prayer, prayer with the pastor. So mark that down. There is no Royal Riders tomorrow night. Normally there is, but due to the 4th of July holiday, the Royal Riders will not be meeting tomorrow night. But Thursday night at 7, the men will be meeting for their men's Bible study. Amen. Mark that down. Wednesday night is family night. Thursday night, men's Bible study. Amen. And then next week, not Sunday, but Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, the VBS Wild West Adventure is going to be in process and progress. And if you can be a part of it, see Pastor Brendan. There is a meeting following next Sunday morning service for those who are volunteering to be a part of VBS. It's going to be a great time and outreach. I'm expecting a great turnout. We've had the opportunity to do a lot of inviting and putting out the flyers and the invitation, and so we're expecting God to bring them in. Amen. Amen. Then on the 23rd of July, the Royce Mitchell Invitational Speed to Light Golf Tournament. See Ed or Don, and they will get you all hooked up for that. The Couples Connection is taking the summer off, and we pray you enjoy the summertime with your spouse, your family, and just enjoy that time together. Donations are needed for the Tammy Twitchell Cystic Fibrosis Ride, which will take place on August the 6th. Registration will be 8 a.m. on that day, and kickstands will be up at 10 a.m. Hallelujah. Then on the 19th of August, it's still a month away, but it's coming quick, Gabby and Lacey's wedding. You need to RSVP as soon as possible. Amen. And if you are interested, ladies, in going to a Joyce Meyer conference in Hershey, PA, November 4th and 5th, see Judy Paul. Amen. Praise God. I believe that's all the announcements this morning. Let's stand and let's worship the Lord. Let's give him glory in the house. He's worthy. Amen.
Search the world, they couldn't fail me. Man's empty praise and treasures to feed are never enough. You gave along, brought me back together. Satisfied, here in your love.
there's nothing better than you, Lord. Oh, we praise you, we praise you, we praise you. Oh, there's nothing better, Lord. Oh, nothing better, Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, we praise your name. Oh, we bless you, Lord. We worship you, we worship you. Voice to him this morning, he is worthy. Hallelujah, Lord, we bless you, we praise you. So
And angels.
Father, the scripture tells us that every good gift and every perfect gift cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom there's neither variableness, neither shadow of turning. And Lord, the greatest gift, the ultimate gift that we can ever receive from the hand of our Maker is the gift of eternal life. I'm so thankful that you are willing to shed your blood. And Lord, tomorrow we're celebrating Independence Day in America. Blood was shed by soldiers of the past to procure our freedom in the present. And Lord, you shed your blood on Calvary's rugged cross in order that we might live eternally. You died so we could live. God commended his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, he died on our behalf and died in our place. God, I thank you for the gift of salvation. I thank you, Lord, the price that was paid that day. And Lord, I just want to give you glory today. God, we don't want to take for granted, Lord, that great gift, that ultimate gift, that incredible gift, unspeakable gift, that you died that we could live. I thank you today for it, and I pray, God, that you would, Lord, just receive the honor, all the praise, all the glory, for it all belongs to you. No one else could die in our stead. No one else could pay the price that we owed. No one else could settle the debt that was on our account. But Jesus paid it all. Thank you, Lord. God, in the remainder of this service, be magnified and exalted, I ask in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. You may be seated this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How many are thankful for Calvary? Amen. I thank God for what he did on that cross, on that rugged hill. Amen. And the Bible tells us in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 11, and it says in verse 23, that I received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it, and he said, take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. And after the same manner, he took the cup also when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show forth the Lord's death till he come. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. Tomorrow is Independence Day. We celebrate our independence from England. And how many know there was a lot of bloodshed in order to procure our independence and our freedom? I want you to know that Jesus shed every ounce of blood in his body on our behalf. That when he hung on the cross and they had beat him with a whip and they had put a crown of thorns in his head, and when they had nailed his feet and his hands to that cross, when they finally were going to thrust a spear into his side, when they did that, it wasn't just blood that came out, it was blood mingled with water, because every drop of blood was used up. How many know he shed all of his blood on your behalf? He shed all of his blood, he gave it all. You know, there's some people that'll give you a little bit of themselves, but they won't let you know the whole real deal. I thank God he loved me with everything he is. And he loved me enough to redeem me and pay the price that I couldn't afford to pay. Amen. You hold in your hand an emblem today that said his body was broken. And I'm going to ask Brother Ricky Paul if he would return thanks for this emblem. And then we will partake of it together.
Father, we thank you for the, you have this, a promise from the very beginning.
another emblem in your hand that said not only was his body broken, but his blood was spilled. The Bible said Jesus is the Lamb that was slain from the foundation of the world. It was God's plan before he ever created man for Jesus to shed his blood. And that blood not only procured our salvation, but our healing as well. Amen. Brother Art Laurie, would you return thanks for this emblem that said Jesus shed his blood for us? At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Amen. Thank you, worship team. Amen. Hallelujah. I want you to turn in your Bibles this morning to the book of Jeremiah, chapter 3. Last week we started a series that we're going to preach for the next few weeks entitled The End of Your Search for the Perfect Church. And last Sunday we declared that there is no perfect church, but if you were to have a perfect church, you would have to have the perfect pastor. You'd have to have the perfect congregation. You'd have to have the perfect facilities. And you'd have to have the perfect worship service. And we determined that there is no perfect pastor. There is no perfect congregation. There is no perfect facility. There is no perfect worship service. But we need to do what we can to produce the best of these that we can possibly produce. Amen? So we're going to start this week and we're going to continue next week on the subject of what do we look for in a pastor when we're looking for a church? Amen? Jeremiah chapter 3 and verse 15. And I will give you pastors according to mine heart, which shall feed you with knowledge and understanding. Let me read that again. And I will give you pastors according to mine heart, which shall feed you with knowledge and understanding. Lord, this morning as we endeavor and attempt to share a word in due season, I pray, God, that, Lord, you would enable me to clarify and speak with clarity your word. I pray, Father, that, Lord, the ears of the listener would be open to hear not what a man would declare, but what the Spirit would speak. I pray, God, that if there's somebody searching for a place to find home, God, I pray that this would be a word that would give them some instruction and direction and guidance in their endeavor to find a place to call home. And I ask it in the name of Jesus and for your glory, I pray. Amen. Now, when you're looking for a church to call home, and the truth of the matter is that too many people today are not committed to a particular body. You've heard me say in the past that when bone came together with bone in Ezekiel 37 in the valley of dry bones, and the prophet prophesied bone came together with bone, it wasn't speaking of unity, it was speaking of attachment. And how God spoke to me as a young man in my first pastorate, and he told me, he said, your leg does not belong on your wife's body. Number one, it would look funny, and number two, it would give her a limp. Your leg belongs on your body, and I want to tell you, I believe every one of us belong to the body that God wants us to belong to, and we need to find that body we belong to, get attached to it, and get a part of it, and be involved in it. Too many church people are church hoppers. They run from one church to the next, and let me tell you, whenever I cut my finger off of my body, the finger dies. The body may hurt for a while, but it will recover, but the finger dies because it loses the blood supply. And I want to tell you, I don't need three legs. I'm not in a three-legged race. I need two legs. So I want you to know, you need to find the body that you belong to, get attached to that body, get involved with that body, support that body, and let that body support you. And when people are looking for a church to call home, it's imperative to find a place where you're comfortable with the leadership in that church. And the church finds its leadership under God in the life of its pastor. And the role of the pastor is different from the other four offices found in Ephesians 4:11. He gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers. You see, the pastor may meet the qualification of any one of the five, but the word pastor speaks of being a shepherd, and therefore the pastor is to be a caregiver. He's to care for the sheep, not just count the sheep. Now, I'm giving you a picture of what my position entails and what the requirements of being in leadership should be and are. Today, a lot of people view ministry as a profession. Did you hear what I said? There are a lot of people that treat pastorship like it's a profession or a job. I want to tell you, pastoring is more than a job. It's a vocation. It is a calling. It's become more than an occupation. It becomes a call, and it starts as a call. And we need today, in the eyes of man, to project the proper image as a pastor. But I want to tell you, I'm more concerned with substance than image. There are a lot of pastors today that are more interested in their accomplishments than in their character. Paul said, if anyone had reason to boast, I have more reason than all of you. I'm circumcised the eighth day. I'm a Pharisee of the Pharisees. Listen, if I wanted to stand up here and produce my pedigree, I could be very braggadocious in what I've seen happen. I can't do anything without him. I have done nothing without him. Every accomplishment in my life has been for the glory of God. He and I have had a deal since I've been in the ministry, and that is, he gets the glory and I take the blame. The glory, the Bible said, we house a treasure in an earthen vessel that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. And when a man wants to promote himself as being a great accomplisher, then he's not really a pastor. He's a superstar. I'm just going to shoot from the hip. And I want to say this, however, respect for pastors is disintegrating because our standards have been lowered. I want you to know the position of a pastor is still a high and a holy calling, regardless of how Hollywood portrays it or religion defines it. When Samuel was about to ordain a leader of God's people based on his external assessment, he looked at Eliab and said, "Surely this is the Lord's anointed." God told him this: man looks on the outward appearance, but God looks on the heart. God's more interested in your character than in your accomplishments. We need to be more concerned with the content than the container. The product more than the package. Too many preachers are more concerned with how they sound than what they say. Remember this, God doesn't call the qualified, he qualifies the called. And I want to draw your attention today to four requirements of a pastor. First requirement that you need to look for in pastoral leadership is the call of God. Not the desire of a man, not the decision of a man to enter into the ministry, the call of God to put somebody into ministry. Ephesians 4:11, and he gave some to be apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. Who gave these positions? God gave them. The fivefold ministry listed here has often been described as God's hand, with each finger representing a different office. The apostle, being the thumb, touches all of the others. The prophet, that's the pointer finger. Amen. The evangelist is the center of it and the farthest reaching, the evangelization. The fourth position, that of the pastoral, is the ring finger, the caring finger. And the teacher, well, you can kind of get that in your ear and clean it out. Fivefold ministry, God's hand, fivefold. Evangelists, pastors, apostles, prophets, and teachers. And God has ordained the office of a pastor with a specific purpose in mind. I wrote an evangelist handbook years ago, and Nolan, you probably got one when it first came out. And let me just read one of these sections that we put in here on the call of God. The fivefold ministry listed in Ephesians 4:11 has been described as God's hand, with each office representing a different finger. Just as each finger is different, each office has a different function. And God has ordained the office of the evangelist or pastor for a specific purpose. Where I have written evangelist, you can insert the word pastor here. Notice the words in Ephesians 4, God gave. Man does not choose ministry. God chooses men for the ministry. And it is sad to see the individual who's decided to try the evangelistic field or the pastoral ministry destroy himself and hurt the church where he ministers. You see, the office that God puts you in is not something you try. It is a mandate from heaven. The call of God is more than a desire in your heart. It's a knowledge of God's will. In Colossians 1:1, Paul describes himself as an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God. Every pastor or evangelist should be able to say, I am a pastor, I am an evangelist, I am a teacher by the will of God. The call of God is personal and real. Moses experienced this at the burning bush. Gideon heard from heaven in a wine press. God spoke to Samuel in the midnight hour. Paul saw the light on the Damascus road, and Peter's revelation came in the form of a dream, and Jeremiah was called from his mother's womb. These men were not listening to personal prophecies. God spoke directly to them. When you look at a pastor, you want to know, why is he in that position? Is he there because he decided to go there, or is he there because God put him there? The old farmer was out in the field, and he looked up into the sky one day, and he saw a big PC, and he said, oh, that means preach Christ. No, it didn't. It meant plant corn. You see, some are sent, and others just went. When I was called into the ministry at the age of 10, God spoke to me about doing evangelistic work and being an evangelist. But then when I left Bible school and went out onto the field, God shut the door and God put a different call on me. I was called to fill in a church that didn't have a speaker on a particular Sunday, and God said, "You're going to pastor that church." I wasn't looking for that, but God's call came. I put out a couple of fleeces, and God answers both those fleeces. And to make a long story short, they turned me down the first time they brought my name up. I was too young. I was only 20. But 16 months later, the pastor they brought in didn't work out, and they got rid of him. And they called me to come, and it was a unanimous decision, and I was voted in to pastor that church. A few years later, I was on a stump in the woods with a 30-30 in my hands hunting. And God spoke to me, and I was pastoring a church 15 miles from where I graduated from high school and where my father was pastoring. And God said, "Get thee up out of thy country, out of thy father's house, away from thy kindred, into a land that I will show thee." And God led me into the next pastorate. Again, they called me to come. I didn't go calling them. They called me, and God took me to Malone, New York. Then God released me onto the evangelistic field, and for the next 17 years, I fulfilled the call God gave me as a 10-year-old boy. Then I was praying about making a change in ministry, and I got a call from Little Falls, New York. They called me, I didn't call them, but God spoke to me and God spoke to them. And through a series of meetings and looking at it and checking it out and praying over it, God opened the doors that no one else could have ever opened, and he put me in a position that God wanted me at. And when it came time to come here, I didn't go looking for it. I had been feeling like God wanted me in this area for some time. As a matter of fact, I had looked into other churches as well before coming, but God knew he wanted me here. And when Art called me one morning, and he said, "We want you to pray about coming here to Horseheads." And we prayed, and we know the story. We came to candidate, and Jennifer said, "I want 100% vote." I said, "You're never going to get 100% vote." At that time, people were leaving and going to other churches. The church was in a downward spiral at the time, and a number of them were contemplating going to other churches. I said, "You have people leaving the church now. You're not going to get 100% vote." So when they came to vote, Jennifer and I went over to the pastor's office, and Brother Fred Francisco, former presbyter of the area, came to take the vote. He came in. He said, "Congratulations. You had an overwhelming decision." And Jennifer said to him, "Was it 100%? He said, "Well, it was a substantial decision." He didn't say. Well, then just before he gave us the results, he said to her, "By the way, it was 100%. You see, God confirmed his call. God confirms his call. It wasn't a matter of me deciding to do something. It was a matter of what God had decided. And when you look for a man to fill a pulpit, you need to find a man that is called by God, not somebody who out of circumstances is pushed into something he wants to try, not that God called him for. I want to ask you, has the church been put in that position? Has the pastor been put in that position for any other reason beside God put him there? Were there underlying circumstances behind his going there that were not necessarily God ordaining him, but him deciding to do it? You need to check these things out when you're looking for a church. You need to find a pastor that is called of God, not deciding to try the ministry and do 100 things on the side. Number two, you need to look for a person of purity. 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse number 2 says this. Do we have that? "A bishop or an overseer, a pastor, then must be blameless, the husband of one wife, vigilant, sober, of good behavior, given to hospitality, apt to teach, blameless, without any credible accusation." And I say credible because you can accuse anybody of anything. go on Facebook and you just say somebody did something, and whether they did it or not. How many know that Job was falsely accused and Joseph was falsely accused? Their reputations were marred, but their character was clean. And you need to find a man whose character is clean, amen, who walks in purity of the call of God. Isaiah 52 and verse number 11 said, depart ye, go ye out from thence, touch no unclean thing, go ye out from the midst of her, be ye clean that bear the vessels of the Lord. When you want a man in your pulpit to be your pastor and to care for you and to be a caregiver, not someone who counts the sheep but cares for them, you need someone that is not going to infect difficult situations and painful situations with the impurity of his life. I just had to address an issue of that in the last few days, where a pastor was put into a position and then they found out there were things in his life that weren't what he declared. And I want to tell you, it's a sad thing when that begins to happen. I'm still dealing with that issue right now. I've been called and I have to respond. Again, I don't want to dismiss somebody based on accusation, but if there's reality and truth behind it, you've got to let them go. And let me tell you something, you need to sterilize the needle before you dig out the splinter. I told you how my mother used to take that little needle when I was a big boy about this high, and she got that little needle that was about that long. We had a gas stove and the flame would come up. She'd stick that needle in the gas flame and it would turn black and it would smoke and smolder. First it would turn red and then it would cool down to be black. And I said, what on earth are you doing? She said, if I'm going to dig that splinter out, I got to make sure there's no way that you're going to get infected by the needle. I'm sterilizing the needle. When we have people involved in some very delicate issues of our lives, and how many know in pastoral ministry you deal with delicate issues? And if your life is messed up, you can contaminate other lives further. You need to make sure that there is no deliberate sin in your life. Amen? Am I saying that as a pastor I am free of sin? No. When a man says he doesn't sin, he makes God a liar and the truth is not in him. But it's not deliberate sin. If there's deliberate sin in a man's life, told you I went to my second church up in Malone, New York, and the church had never grown. And it all of a sudden, over the last couple of years, it started to grow, and it went from like 10 or 15 people to about 70. And the district office called me and said, Joe, we want you to go to Malone. The church has never grown. It started to grow, and we think that you can lead it into revival. We want you to go. Well, they didn't tell me the reason the church had grown. The reason the church had grown was because the man that was in the pulpit before I went there that saw the growth would preach nothing but grace and mercy, love and forgiveness, but he would preach no holiness, no godliness, and he would take him into membership, drinking, smoking, living in sin, doing all kinds of sinful activity. He'd give him membership because he was committing adultery the entire time. He couldn't preach anything but grace. He couldn't preach anything but forgiveness because he would have had to live it. And so because he preached what they wanted to hear, people came in. There was no standard. And when I went in and I started to preach holiness and righteousness, we had a great increase from 70 to 10 in a year and a half. Church began to flourish because I didn't understand why it had grown to begin with, but then I found out why. And his life impacted other lives in a negative way. I want to tell you something. When you're looking for somebody to fill your pulpit, you better get somebody that's godly. You need to find somebody with character, not who is a character. Amen? You see, look at the effect on the church that men who have fallen into sin have had on the church. Look how when Jimmy Swaggart fell years ago, God restored him and God is using him again. But I don't believe it's the same as it once was. But during that time, there were a lot of people that were impacted in a negative way because of his sin. And if I'm out as your pastor and I'm out doing all kinds of wickedness, hey, pastor's down at the bar brawling with everybody, chasing others, men's wives, and how is that going to impact the church? You see, you got to have somebody that has character, moral character. He may not be perfect, but he is living for the Lord. And like Paul, he said, not that I've attained, not that I've arrived, but this one thing I do. I forget those things which are behind, and I press on toward the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. I don't allow deliberate sin to rule and reign in my life. That's what you've got to look for when you call a man to pastor your church and you're looking for a church you want to attend. Look at the life of the pastor. Somebody said we're not to judge one another. Let me tell you, you'll know them by their fruit. The Bible said, prove all things. You need to check me out. I'm not going to hide and say, hey, you're not perfect. Don't bother looking at me. Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ. And if a pastor's not willing to say that, you need to maybe decide whether you want to continue to follow that man's leadership. I need to be open enough to say, follow me as I follow Christ. Am I going to be perfect? No. But am I going to be godly? Yes. You see, as long as there's not deliberate open sin in my life, you can submit to my leadership. But if there is defiant, deliberate sin in my life, you need to say, get out of here, Jack. You need either get rid of me or you need to get out of here. Right? You don't need to follow a man who doesn't endeavor to live this life and allow God to work in his heart. Remember Isaiah, when he saw the Lord high and lifted up and his train filled the temple, and the seraphim flew one to another and said, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is filled with his glory. What's the first thing Isaiah said? He didn't say, by my book, I've had a great revelation. I'm a great man. I am a wonderful man. He said, hey, listen, I got trouble, man. Woe is me. I'm undone. I'm a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. But then what happened? When he confessed to God where he was at, then flew one of the seraphim unto him, having a live coal which he had taken with tongs from off the altar, laid it upon his mouth and said, lo, this has touched thy lips, thy iniquity is taken away, thy sin is purged. And he said, then I heard God say, who will I send and who will go for us? And he said, here am I, send me. But until he got touched on the mouth, and how many know the tongue no man can tame? And when God's got your tongue, he's got you. And when the fire got a hold of Isaiah's tongue, the fire got a hold of Isaiah. And it cleansed him. Lo, this has touched thy lip. Thine iniquity is taken away. Thy sin is purged. You are cleansed. You are made holy, righteous. And then and only then could God use Isaiah in the ministry. I look at the priests who would go into the holy place to minister. Before they could go into the holy place, they had to wash in the laver. They had to clean up the outside, but it was a type of cleaning the inside, that before you go into the Holy of Holies, the high priest could not have sin in his life that was unconfessed or undealt with. If he went into the Holy of Holies with sin in his life, God struck him dead. Let me tell you this, be sure your sin will find you out. Don't think you can cover your sin and get away with it. God does not wink at sin. God will bring to light the hidden things. Amen? Hallelujah. God will expose those things that need to be exposed. Now look at Eli and his sons. Eli was the high priest. His sons Hophni and Phinehas were the priests, and they were committing all kinds of sin down at the temple, and Eli just blinked his eye and pretended nothing was wrong. but God didn't. God called Samuel and said, I want you to deal with Eli, your teacher, your mentor. And Samuel said, I'm just a kid. God said, don't worry about it, I'll take care of it. They went to war with the Philistines in chapter 4 of 1 Samuel, and the Philistines were winning the fight. And as they were winning the fight, the Israelites said, call for the Ark of the Covenant to bring it out here that we can win. But what happened in that fight is this. They brought the Ark of the Covenant out, and the Philistines captured it, took the Ark of the Covenant, the presence of God, out of the land of Israel. Phinehas' wife gave birth to a son they named Ichabod. The glory is departed. Hophni and Phinehas died in the battle, and then Eli died as well. God took him out of the picture because Eli wouldn't deal with it. You have to deal with sin in the camp. You have to deal with sin in the pulpit. Not just in the pew, but in the pulpit. And if the pastor's in deliberate sin, it needs to be addressed. Not only must the pastor have the call of God on his life, not only must he be a person of purity, but he needs to be a person of prayer. Acts chapter 6 and verse 4, but we, this is the apostle saying, we will give ourselves continually to prayer and the ministry of the word. You've heard me say, I don't care if you have a PhD. If you don't have a BWJ, you're not getting in the pulpit. Been with Jesus. Amen. They knew that Peter and John were unlearned and ignorant men, but they took knowledge they had been with Jesus. Matthew 6 and verse 6 says, but thou, if thou prayest, wait a minute, let me read that again. But thou, if thou, when thou prayest, not if, when thou prayest, enter into thy closet, and when thou hast shut thy door, pray to thy Father which is in secret, and thy Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly. How many know that private prayer produces public power? Peter found direction for his ministry while he was praying on the rooftop. Hezekiah found victory when he was praying, when he was told to set his house in order, he would die, and God gave him an extra 15 years. Jesus found strength to go to the cross while he was praying in the Gethsemane's garden. Great men of God have always been great on their knees. The Wesleys, the Finneys, the Wigglesworth would spend hours a day in prayer before the day began. Daniel knew the importance of a healthy prayer life. It was three meals a day from the table of God's divine presence that gave him a testimony that changed a nation. Prayer kept him from compromising his convictions. Moses had to go to the mountain and spend time alone with God before he could come back down to the valley and give something to the people. And before I can stand in the pulpit, I need to get in the closet. If I don't go to touch God in prayer, I have nothing to give you on Sunday. I can't just pick up somebody else's sermon and copy it and read it. I'm not built that way. I remember years ago, back in the early 80s, when Jimmy Swaggart Ministries was sending out all these opportunities to have him preach in your church via satellite. He said, you just send us a little bit of money and we'll live stream. This was back in the early 80s. We'll send the copy of our ministry into your pulpit on Sunday morning. I thought to myself, can I not hear from God for my flock? Let me tell you what, you need to find a man who's praying about what he's preaching on. You need to find a man who's praying for you, not just for his preaching, but for your healing and your encouragement and your deliverance. You need to find somebody that cares enough about you to pray about you. My mom and dad spent hours every morning praying for their congregation, for their family, for their friends. They would seek God with tears in their eyes, and they wouldn't get up from the chair and the couch until God was done ministering to them and through them. Number four, your pastor needs to have the call of God. He needs to be a person of purity. He needs to be a person of prayer. And finally, he needs to be a person of passion. My brother Larry once said, he said, if I'm looking for a man to fill the pulpit and be my pastor, I don't care what kind of a degree he has behind his name. I'm not looking for the PhD or the D-min. I'm looking for a man who's been through hell and back and still has the joy of the Lord as his strength. I want somebody that can help me get through what I'm going through when I'm going through it. I don't care how much education he has. I don't care how much intellect he has. I want to know how much experience he has with the glory of God and the power of God. Can he get through it? And if he can get through it, I know I can get through it. Galatians 6:9, be not weary in well-doing, for in due season you will reap if you faint not. Amen? You need to be a person of passion. Don't give up. Don't become weary in your well-doing. Nehemiah 8:10 says, the joy of the Lord is my strength. In Acts 5 and verse 41, and they departed from the presence of the council, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer shame for his name. You need to check out how your pastor responds to adversity. Does he collapse? Does he freak out? Does he throw in the towel? Does he quit? Does he run away? Does he leave? Acts 20 and verse 24 said, but none of these things move me, Paul said. Neither count I my life dear unto myself, so that I might finish my course with joy, and the ministry which I have received of the Lord Jesus to testify the gospel of the grace of God. What kind of a testimony is a man who's miserable in the ministry? I'm not telling you ministry is easy, and I'm not telling you there are not moments where you find discouragement. There are times when a pastor can get discouraged. Look at Elijah, suicidal. Look at Paul, cursed the day he was born. Job, cursed the day he was born. Moses asked God to take his life. All of the men of God that did anything great for God came to a place in their life where they wanted to quit. But the question is not, are you going to get to that place? The question is, which way do you turn when you reach the stop sign? I've had a lot of opportunities in the ministry to leave the ministry. People have left the ministry for a lot less reasons than I've had in the past. Amen? I could have just thrown in the towel and said, it's not worth it. It's not anything I'm interested in continuing. But I want to tell you, the one thing that keeps you going when the devil wants to get you to quit is that call of God that I talked about in the beginning. The call of God lingers when your desire dies. You can't shake the call of God. You can't shake the will of God. You can't shake that I've got to keep on going on because God won't let me quit. And you look at the man of God and ask yourself, is he going to be an example to me that I'll continue when I want to give up? Is he going to have the right attitude when he's going to? And let me tell you, every day I have is a blessed day, but it's not always a fun day. There's days, how many know that Calvary was not a lot of fun? Jesus didn't go up there to have fun. He went up there to accomplish a work, and he did it with joy. Amen? Moses chose rather to suffer affliction with the children of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. You think Moses had a good day every day he got up into the leadership position? Every day that the people murmured and complained? Every day that Korah raised up 250 leaders to try to tear him down? Every day that his brother and sister rose up against him? Every day that he got frustrated with the people and wanted to smack that rock instead of speak to it? No, but he had to pick himself up each day. And I want to tell you something. Paul said none of these things moved me. He was stoned, left for dead, shipwrecked, beaten, flogged. Look at his resume and what he went through. But he said, none of these things move me, that I may finish my course with joy. Doesn't mean that I'm always happy, but I always have the joy of the Lord. How many know happiness and joy are two different things? Happiness is like the surface and joy is down deep. When the storm is raging and the waves are rising and falling and ebbing and flowing, the surface of the ocean may be choppy, but if you go down deep, it's calm. Happiness is the surface and joy is the depth. And a man can have joy even if he's not always happy. I heard Ray Hughes say that I used to preach the happiest place in the world was the center of God's will, till I learned you don't have to be happy to be in God's will. Jonah was not happy going to Nineveh, but it was the center of God's will. Jesus wasn't necessarily happy about dying. He said, if there's any other way, let's take that. Nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. You need to check out the pastor. What is his attitude in adversity? Is he a quitter? Is he a complainer? Is he somebody that can't handle the stress? Is he somebody that's going to have ulcers and freak out because he can't deal with it? Or is he the one that casts his care on God because God cares for him? Paul and Silas knew how to pray and sing praises in the midnight hour. And because of their willingness to praise God in the hour of trial, God sent deliverance and released them, and their ministry not only continued, but it increased as a jailer and his whole family got saved. My father, I've said in the past, I'm not a fraction of the man my dad was. I've been privileged to go places my dad never went, see things my dad never saw, but I'm not the fraction of the man my father was. Whenever my dad would go through difficult times, and believe me, he went through a lot of difficult times, but you'd never know it, because he always had a song. He was singing constantly, always had a smile on his face. I'd say, Dad, why don't you smack those people up? He said, God will take care of them. I'd say, well, he'd use me in a heartbeat, Dad. God said, settle down. Dad said, settle down, son. Watch God work. I remember when he went on vacation, and while he was away, the entire church board and the assistant pastor started going door to door to draw people out of the church when he was away on vacation. Came home to deal with that issue, but God dealt with it, and God took those people out of the church. My dad didn't have to. They all decided they were going to leave because there was a church open, so the three of the four of them went to this church to pastor it together. Another church opened, so two left to go to the other church in one state, and before long, both churches folded, and all three of those men backslid. My dad didn't have to do a thing. He just kept singing and smiling and loving. That doesn't mean he didn't address the issue. That didn't mean he didn't confront them. But he didn't have to go angry and frustrated. I know two pastors that came to me on separate occasions and said to me, you know, Joe, the reason we're still in the ministry is your father. We were going to give up. They both said it individually, and these were older men, seasoned in the ministry, men of position. They said to me, the reason we've continued in the ministry is because of your father's testimony. Because everywhere he went, he was so joyful and so loving, and we know what he'd gone through. And yet he handled it. And because of his testimony, we've continued in the ministry when we both contemplated quitting. Dad had a contagious spirit. When I'm looking for a man to fill the pulpit, I'm not going to find the perfect man. We talked about Moses and his flaws, Paul and his flaws, Peter and his flaws, all of the men of God that did anything for God. We house a treasure in an earthen vessel. They weren't perfect men, but every one of them had a call of God. Every one of them were men of purity. Every one of them were men of prayer. And every one of them were men of passion. And if you're looking for a church to call home, if you're looking for a church to plug into, because how many know it's important where you attend? And it's important, let me say this via live stream, it's important that you do attend church. Church is not just about what you get from it, it's what you give to it. And you can't contribute if you're not there. COVID has done a disservice to the kingdom of God. And I'm not just chastising, but I'm telling you, you're missing out when you don't get in the house of God. You're missing the fellowship of the saints, the anointing of the Holy Ghost, and you're missing the opportunity to pour into somebody else that might need you. You may not need church, but church needs you. But when you're looking for a church to call your home church, you need to have some standards. Next week, I'm going to talk about the responsibility of the pastor. Then the week after, I'm going to deal with the congregation and what do we look for in a congregation. Right now, I'm focusing on the leadership and I'm letting you look into the window of my life. And I'm asking you to take a look into the window of my life. I'm asking you to say, let me check him out. I'm not afraid to do that. I welcome that. Because if there's corrections that need to be made, I need to make them. But you need to be aware of what is in the pulpit and who is in the pulpit if you're going to be a part of that body. Amen? If I'm intentionally out lying, am I intentionally out stealing? If I'm intentionally out building my own ego, if I'm intentionally out doing things that takes away from the glory of God and draws attention to myself, you need to deal with that. Deal with me. But if I am doing what God calls me to do, you need to submit to the authority that God's put in the church, according to Hebrews. Amen? Submit yourselves to them that have rule over you, that they... as they that watch, they that must give an account for your souls, that they do it with joy and not with grief, for that's unprofitable for you. Amen? We'll get into that when it comes to the congregation. But take a look around and see what you've got in the church you attend. And if this is not your home church, I'm not just preaching it for Central, although I'm preaching it to Central. See what you've got in the leadership that you have. Amen? You might say, we need to deal with this man, or you might say, thank God we have a leadership that we have. Either way, it needs to be done. I'm not afraid to get in the pulpit and preach about the position I hold. Some men wouldn't do it because there's two reasons. One, you think you're drawing attention to yourself. And number two, you're afraid people might actually take you up on examining you. I have an obligation to preach the whole counsel of God, and I can't draw myself out of that circle. I have to be able to put myself out there and say, follow me as I follow Christ. And if I'm not following Christ, I need to know. And you need to know. But if the leadership is following the Lord, you need to yield and submit to that authority unless it contradicts the Word of God. Amen? So I'm going to leave you with that today, the end of your search for the perfect church. Step one in looking for a perfect pastor, you're not going to find him. Step two, check these qualifications out. Is he called of God, or did he just desire to go into the ministry to try it out? Is he a man of purity? Is he a man of prayer? Is he a man of passion? I know the Bible said in communion, let a man examine himself, and I have to examine myself. But I'm also here for the church to check out. Prove all things. Try the spirits. See if they're of God or not. Check it out. I challenge you to do so. Amen. Father, I thank you for the church. You birthed the church on the day of Pentecost, and you went on to say, I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. And Lord, in building the church, you have put leadership in position that, Lord, you want to govern and guide and guard your flock. And I pray, God, Lord, that we would search and we would examine and we would check out that leadership that, Lord, is in the pulpit where we attend. God, I pray, Lord, that we would have godly leadership. I pray, Lord, that we would have spiritual headship. I pray, God, that, Lord, we would not be simply nitpicking complainers looking for every jot and tittle, but we would truly examine the heart and we would look at the lifestyle. And I pray, God, that, Lord, you would build your church by building your leadership. And, Lord, let us be a blessing to the body and not merely a blessing to ourselves. God, may our heart be for others and not self-centered. God, now I pray in Jesus' name, Lord, that you would just continue to build Central Assembly as a part of your body, a part of your church, and let it grow and let it flourish and let it be a healthy body. And Lord, we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's stand this morning. Amen. The end of your search for the perfect church. It's quiet in here today. Look and see the leadership that you have. Pray about it. And if you can do nothing else for me that is of great importance, let me tell you the greatest thing you'll ever do for me. You need to pray for me daily. You need to pray for Pastor Brendan daily. You need to pray for the leadership of this church daily, because we need your prayers. Amen. And I covet your prayers. I'm not a perfect pastor, never claimed to be, but I want to be a man of God. My prayer when I started, I can take you to the very sidewalk, walking past the school in Bolton Landing, New York, walking up the hill. And I began to pray to God, and I said, Lord, I don't care if I've ever known as a great preacher. I don't care if I'm ever known as a great evangelist. I don't care if I've ever known as a great pastor, but God, my prayer is this: make me a man of God. That's my heart's cry. And I'm going to challenge you to pray that for me. Make our pastor a man of God. A man that not only hears from God, but he walks with God and he shares what God has shared with him. That he walks in wisdom, he walks in patience, he walks in understanding, he walks in compassion. Because I don't care what people think about me, I'm concerned with what God knows about me. And as your pastor, I have to be concerned about how I affect you. I have to give an account as one that watches for your souls. I don't have to give an account for you and how you live, but I have to give an account for how I lead and how I feed. I have to give an account as one that watches for your souls, but I ask you, as I look out for your lives, that you'd pray for me and lift me up before the throne of God on a daily basis. I need your prayers. I covet your prayers. Amen. I thank God for the congregation that God's allowed me to pastor. I thank God for every one of you. I've said this before, and I don't just say it to verbalize the words. I say it because it's my heart. This is the best congregation around. I'm grateful to God to be pastoring this flock. I love every one of you, and I appreciate you, but I covet you lifting me up in prayer, surrounding me with prayer. Amen. Father, I thank you for this congregation. I thank you for this assembly. Thank you for this flock. I thank you for these sheep. And Lord, I pray, God, I would be a shepherd that cares for the flock. That, God, I would not be a hireling that flees when the wolf comes. But, God, I would lay down my life for his sheep. God, I pray, Lord, today that you would go with us as we dismiss this service. And, Lord, I pray that tomorrow when families gather to celebrate our freedom and our liberty in this country, that, Lord, they would remember it's all because of you. It's because of the men and women that sacrificed, but ultimately it's because of the God that we have served and lived for. And God, may we continue to lift up Jesus in this land that we live in. May Jesus be continued to be the center of our life. And God, I pray, God, you would not only build your church, but Lord, you would restore America, Father, to its righteous position. God, I pray, Lord, morals would matter again. And I pray in Jesus' name, Lord, that you would begin to right the wrongs that have been committed. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you today. We love you. Have a blessed weekend.
On Christ alone, our chief cornerstone.